our Indian way, Namaste. Friends, I don't know how many of you, I think all of you are from commerce background?
Yes.
Okay. I belong to UITN as well. I'm a BCom chartered accountant. So I understand your thoughts pretty well. Friends, how many of you are aware of the significance of today? Can you raise your hands? What is the significance of today? Why are we here? Well, you know, he has introduced it as Kargil Vijay Diwas. How many of you are aware of what has happened in Kargil or the Kargil war? I'm not going to ask you questions, but at least some basic awareness somebody has. Can you lift your hands? Well, this is the problem with us. There is a general lack of awareness of what is happening in our borders, what is happening in our country. A rich nation of this magnitude cannot survive unless we are secured here. Today you are able to sit here in peace, you are able to study and hope to get some jobs or career, all thanks to what is happening in our borders. We are safe and secured in our positions here because of the sacrifices of those brave soldiers on the borders. It is very important that we always remember those who have given their today or their day for our tomorrow. That is why we are here. In 1999, I am not sure how many of you were born, or probably you were all small kids, probably then, maybe 2 or 3 year old kids, or probably some of you are not even born, I am not sure. This Kargil war happened in the year 1999. Since I understand that there is a general lack of awareness, I think I will go a little deeper into the history. Probably you didn't have time to remember what was taught in your school. Let's recollect it a bit. I will start with a statement made by a famous Spanish philosopher. He said, "Those who ignore history are condemned to repeat it." I'm using these words again. Those who ignore history are condemned to repeat it. We are all condemned to repeat it. So, India constantly had invasions after invasions for thousands of years, starting from the Greeks, Alexander's invasion, right down up to British and Portuguese. Thousands of years, more than 2000 years, we had invasions in this country. What were our weaknesses? Why did we allow these people to come in? We were such a advanced, civilized society, but why did we allow them? Because we were ignoring history. So we kept repeating these mistakes. It is important that the generation now, your generation, which is going to take over the reins of this country, should be aware of basic history. That is the reason why we need to celebrate such days which are significant in our history. Let's get back to what happened in Kargil. We all know that we got independence in 1947. But soon after independence, of course, that is not the topic of today's discussion. Maybe some other day when you have time, we could probably talk about it. The whole Kashmir problem, we could talk about it. In 1948, legally the whole state of Jammu and Kashmir, or what they call as Kashmir Riyasat, merged into India. The same way as every other kingdom in the country, Travancore, Kapurthala, Patiala, you name it, all these Junagadh, all these states merged into India. 500 independent princely states merged into India. Similarly, Kashmir also merged into India in 1948. What happened was, Pakistan had used some 5,000 Kabbalis, or they call it Pathans, to infiltrate into parts of the state of Jammu and Kashmir. They occupied certain part of Jammu and Kashmir. What we all call today as Pakistan occupied Kashmir. Actually, it is split into two parts. There is one Pakistan occupied Kashmir, and the northern part, what they call as northern areas, is called Gilgit-Baltistan. That is not Pakistan occupied Kashmir. Pakistanis call that Azad Jammu Kashmir, AJK. If you go and check it out on Google Earth, you would find it as AJK. that is in the Muzaffar Kotli area to the west of line of control. The northern part is called Gilgit and Baltistan. So the features are very different. They look like Chinese, and majority of them were Buddhists at one point in time before they became Muslims. The ethnicity is completely different to the Muzaffarabad ethnicity. So when they occupied it, India could push them out to a certain extent. The town of Baramulla was almost captured by these people. We pushed them out beyond Udi town. Udi, I'm sure all of you would have remembered, a year back there was an attack by militants and 23 of our Jawans were killed in Udi. So beyond Udi, the Pakistan army was pushed. But by then, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, our Prime Minister, went to United Nations to seek ceasefire. So that is the ceasefire line, was that what we call today as line of control. But, you know, part is under Pakistani control right now. So when you go north, north of Kashmir Valley, you get this valley called Mushko Valley. From where on you enter into Ladakh Valley. You should understand, I encourage all of you to please go through the Indian maps in Google Earth or Google Maps to understand the terrain. What our territory is all about. You should have an understanding of our ground realities. It's actually very interesting. If you go through Google Earth, you can see the photographs, you can see the valleys, you can see contours. It's really educative. Whenever you have free time, you should be able to spend some time on Google Earth and then educate yourself. So the state of Jammu and Kashmir, which is under Indian control, is divided into three divisions. Like in Andhra Pradesh, we had Telangana, Rayalaseema, and Andhra. We had three divisions. Similarly, the state of Jammu and Kashmir had three divisions. The Kashmir Valley, Jammu region, and Ladakh. So the areas which I am talking about, north of Mushko Valley, where Kargil falls, that comes under Ladakh region. It does not come under Kashmir Valley. So we need to have this understanding. It does not come under Kashmir Valley. It comes under Ladakh region. And there is also, even the religious end also, Kargil is different. It is largely predominantly Sunni Islam, or to a certain extent even Sufi Islam in the Kashmir Valley. Kargil is predominantly Shia. So there is a cultural divide also between these two. And Kargil residents are looking more like ethnic Ladakhis and Baltis, not like Kashmiris. Their ethnicity is also completely different. And we hear so many stories of militant attacks, terrorist attacks in Kashmir. But have you heard any attack or any encounter happening or stone pelting in Kargil? They are also Muslims, by the way. But they are patriotic Muslims who want to be part of India. That is Kargil for us. So, unfortunately, in the TV news and the paper that we all listen, we hear only one-sided story. The Kashmir Valley is full of militants, terrorists, you know, what have you. All this problem is only in about 4 to 5 districts of Kashmir. The rest of the Kashmir Valley, including the northern part of Kashmir, which is called Burez, Machil sector, they are all very much pro-India. Almost 99% they are all Muslims, but they are very much pro-India. Sadly, none of our newspapers or television channels tell us this reality. Kashmir is not all about anti-India. The whole of Jammu and whole of Ladakh is wanting to be part of India. Just 4 or 5 districts in the central Kashmir, we have a problem. So that is Kargil for you. It's a town which is the closest to line of control. So there is a national highway called NH1D, National Highway 1D. Which goes from Srinagar to Leh. Leh is the capital of Ladakh. So it passes through many towns, and Kargil is the town which is the closest to line of control. It is from the Kargil town, there is a mountain. Just behind the mountain is line of control. So if they fire a missile, it straight lands into Kargil town. That close it is. So you need to understand this topography. After Kargil, the line of control turns north, whereas the national highway goes south. So only Kargil is vulnerable. Beyond that, it is beyond the reach of Pakistani firing. This is the typical terrain of this place. Please imagine your eye that this is how the topography is. We have a line of control which goes north of the national highway, comes very close to Kargil. This is the scenario. Now what has happened historically, we all know. In 1965, India had a war with Pakistan, and then we had a war with Pakistan again in 1971. In 1971, we all know that Bangladesh was created, which was prior to that called East Pakistan. So it broke away from Pakistan and it became Bangladesh, an independent country. So that itself defeated the very notion of creating Pakistan. What was the reason given when they created Pakistan? They said Muslims cannot live with Hindus and Muslims need a separate country. So what happened? Same Muslims of Bengal did not want to live with Pakistan. So obviously religion is not binding people. It is their culture, it is their history, it is their brotherhood of the place where they are born and brought up that matters. We all know that Indian Muslims are the most patriotic people. We have so many people in Kargil who sacrificed to become martyred for the nation. So we don't see religious ethnicity or anything else in this country. If it's an Indian, it's an Indian, period. Whereas the very reason why Pakistan was created was at a religious line. And that got defeated in 1971 when Bangladesh was created. However, the insult of losing East Pakistan is hurting Pakistanis very deeply, very badly. So they wanted to take revenge on India. So they started this incursion, they started this jihadi movement in Kashmir, and we know we are all suffering, we hear stories. We have seen bomb blasts happening in Lumbini Park and Kobul Chat in Hyderabad as well. We have seen a lot of issues happening in the rest of the country as well. Pakistan wants to bleed India for 1,000 years. That is their stated philosophy. So as part of that, they kept on doing incursions. 1965 also, they did an incursion in Jammu region, and so it went into a full-scale war. What they had a long-term strategy was to capture Kargil, because if they capture Kargil, Ladakh region is cut off from the country. The only road which connects Ladakh goes via Kargil from Srinagar. The second road which goes from Himachal has to go through very, very difficult terrain, and the road is unviable more than 6 to 7 months in a year. So literally Ladakh is cut off. If Ladakh is cut off, it's open field for Pakistan and China to do what they want. India seized the opportunity to go and occupy very inhospitable terrain in Siachen Glacier. Siachen Glacier is almost 20 to 24,000 feet above sea level. It's completely frozen. You can't breathe properly. If you breathe, you'll start spitting out ice crystals from your nose. It is that tough. And you don't have water to wash anything. They wash it with liquor, whiskey and rum, they use it, because that doesn't freeze. Because you can't have water, and you can't put your hands in boiling water. If you put it in boiling water, your hand will burn. That is the situation what it is there in Siachen. Those Siachen heights India occupied in 1984. So Pakistan is seething with vengeance and anger that they wanted to show India its place. They wanted to give a befitting reply to India. So they tried, they planned, they did a lot of things, it didn't happen. This Kargil incursion they were planning for quite some time. They gave this proposal, three prime ministers had rejected this plan. So what did he do? He did not tell the Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif what he was planning. He and four officers stealthily planned this, built up logistics, sent ammunition, food to the forward areas, and till March the entire passes are filled with snow. Nobody can even walk there. So traditionally it is so high, 18,000 feet above sea level. So both the armies, they vacate the forward posts that on the line of control there are bunkers, there are posts. So nobody can stay in such a winter season, and you have to climb, there are no roads there. You have to climb for 3-4 days to get there. So traditionally before that, both the armies used to vacate those posts and come and reoccupy in summer. That was a practice, because there is nobody living there, they are all inhospitable terrain. But this time around what Pakistan did, is before Indian army could move into their old bunkers, they moved into Indian bunkers. They came and stealthily occupied all Indian bunkers across a range of 160 kilometers. That is from Mushko Valley to another valley called Turtuk. Turtuk is very close to Siachen Glacier. So between this, almost 160 kilometers of all the peak they occupied. Now what has happened? They are able to directly look at your Indian National Highway 1D. It is completely directly under their fire. So they could sit there and choose, pinpoint any army vehicle and they could shoot it. So our entire defense, our entire Ladakh, Siachen, was completely threatened by this occupation forces which occupied. So Pakistan, they were not so matured enough then. But the newspaper, their official narrative, everything was trying to tell people that it was just Mujahideen, Kashmiri freedom fighters who have occupied these sites. But later on, now it has come to be known that Special Services Group and North Light Infantry, two divisions of Pakistan, had occupied. There were Mujahideens to help them out, but to somebody to operate at such heights with such precision, no Mujahideen can handle it. It needs a professional army to handle it. Obviously, this was the work of Pakistani army which occupied all these heights. And this was a plan Musharraf had devised. He had taken the Prime Minister there. He did not show the line of control. Yet, what they did is, he said, you know, our people are trying to trouble Indians here and there. He just gave a very broad indication to Nawaz Sharif. Nawaz Sharif had no clue where the line of control is, where Pakistani position is, where Indian position is. So, when this incursion happened, on 3rd May 1999, some shepherds saw the Pakistani posts and informed the Indian army. And on 5th May, India sent a contingent of 5 officers to inspect what is happening to evict them. And all these 5 people were captured by the Pakistanis, brutally tortured and killed. Triggered a massive amount of response from India. The tortured bodies, when they came back, the description, unfortunately, media has not shared it. You know, needles were plucked into their nails. Their eyelashes were removed and, the description goes on and on. Such torturous way they were tortured and killed. Once these 5 people were killed, India's response started. That is when they realized that it is not some Mujahideen, but it is deeply entrenched professional Pakistani army which had taken over all the peaks. So then India realized something has happened. Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji, he called up Nawaz Sharif and said, what is happening? Why are your guys in across the line of control? So Nawaz Sharif said that is the first time he's hearing that his army has invaded. That means, since the earlier Prime Ministers of Pakistan refused this plan, Musharraf did not even inform his Prime Minister. Army took its own decision and invaded LOC. So for the best part of this campaign, they tried to hide it. And please understand, when you are sitting on top of a mountain, 5 people is equal to 50 people below. You are completely vulnerable. You have to scale a wall. So you are completely vulnerable. They can pick and shoot, choose and shoot you. So it is almost impossible. Attrition levels are very high if you have to scale those kinds of mountains. You cannot do it in the daytime. You have to do it in the night. Night, we can't even walk on streets here in city when there are no lights. Just imagine climbing a mountain, steep mountain in pitch dark where you have no light. You can't even switch on your torchlight because you will immediately see and shoot you down. And freezing, minus 48 degrees. Ice is formed at 0 degrees Celsius. We are talking about minus 48 degrees Celsius. Can you imagine? Minus 48 degrees, these people have to scale these heights. And I encourage all of you to travel to Ladakh and to Kargil to understand what our border positions are. Ladakh is so high, Leh is almost 12,000 feet above sea level. Now we are talking about 18,000 feet in the operation area. 12,000 feet, nothing grows. There is no oxygen there in the air. Thin oxygen. Trees don't grow there. You will find it difficult to breathe. If you go to Leh, you'll have to sit inside your room for 2 days, 48 hours, before you can venture out. Otherwise, you'll get altitude sickness. It's same for any soldier. He is also a human being. He cannot straight away go and attack them. So when there is an incursion, you take what is called as acclimatization period. It takes about 7 days for people to be acclimatized. And then you have to carry your food, your ammunition, your communication equipment, everything you have to carry up the hill. It's virtually an inhuman act to do it. But we had to do it. So India took a lot of attritions. Since Pakistan was also a nuclear power, Vajpayee took a decision that India will not cross that line of control. We shall remain the rightful people. They made a mistake, but that doesn't mean we have a right to do that. So he gave instructions to the army and the air force not to cross the line of control, but evict these people. So they are sitting on a mountain. Below that mountain is their supply lines. Had the prime minister given us the permission, we could have cut their supply lines off. The army, air force would have cut them off. So it would have been easy for us to handle them. But the supply chains were still there. They were getting their ammunition, their food, everything was coming up there. So for Indian army to evict them was very, very tough. So Indian army, luckily these Bofors guns, which is very notorious for the Bofors scandal, it came off good. Bofors fired on many of their positions. Though it was not that accurate, it could take off many of their entrenched positions. Then on 26th of May, Indian Air Force also joined in. But please understand, they were not allowed to cross the line of control. So within the line of control territory, they had to operate. So if they cross it, they could be shot. Unfortunately, that too happened. Two of our fighter aircraft we lost. One engine stalled, and so its flight lieutenant Nachiketa had to eject himself out. And he fell inside the territory which was under Pakistani control. So his colleague, squadron leader Ajay Ahuja, wanted to rescue him. So he tried to go closer to the place where he is ejected. So he was shot down by sniper, handheld missile was shot at, and his aircraft was taken out. So the story tells that he survived that attack, but he was captured, tortured, and his bullet-ridden body was returned to India after the Kargil war was over. So this is the sad part which has happened there. And one more Mi-17 helicopter had gone to shoot out their bunkers. They used a Stinger missile and shot it down as well. So India lost two aircrafts and one helicopter in this war. Overall, we lost roughly about 530 soldiers we lost, and about 13 to 1400 injuries we had. And the numbers on the Pakistani side are camouflaged because they don't want their public to know the truth about anything about 1000 people, 1000 to 1500 people, as per the Indian estimates. Nawaz Sharif, later on when he lost his prime ministership, he said they lost 4000 people in the heights. So this was a war which was fought for the first time in the world by two nuclear armed powers. Before that, no two nuclear armed powers ever fought a conventional war. So there was always a risk of this escalating to a nuclear war. Pakistan had moved its nuclear equipment to the Kargil area. This is the US intelligence had gathered. But later on, Musharraf said, we had tested only 1 year back and our bombs are not ready. They were not fully prepared for it. However, the intelligence was that they could use a nuclear weapon on India. So India had to be little restrained in their response. And then it was not a full blown war. Only in a certain sector of 160 kilometers this war was going on. So our Navy was not involved. However, Navy was fully prepared to blockade the Karachi port if Pakistan used either nuclear weapons or they were going to take the attack to any other sector. So Navy was fully prepared, but they did not participate in this. Effectively, roughly about 25 to 30,000 Indian soldiers were involved in this Kargil effort. And some of the names have been made famous by some of the Bollywood movies. LOC Kargil, I'm sure, I don't know if some of you would have seen that. Lakshya, many movies that came based on this Kargil topic. And some of the names have become very famous. Pardon? No, not China. This is Pakistan. Ajay Ahuja, I already told you, who was martyred. Then we have Major Padmapani Acharya. There are so many others. Hanifuddin, Captain Hanifuddin. There are so many people who sacrificed. Major Saravanan, he had individually taken out more than 4 bunkers, and while taking out the 5th bunker, he was shot and he died. They could not retrieve his body for more than 2 days, because the enemy sniper fire was going on. So they could not take his body, bring the body back for more than 2 days. So it is such a difficult situation for Indian Army. We finally managed to evict most of these people in the first week of July. There are some names you should know. There is a peak called Tololing Peak. There is a peak called Tiger Hills. Tiger Hills was bombarded by Bofors guns. So Tiger Hills is a very majestic mountain which you can see after you cross Kargil towards Dras. So there is a place called Patalik. Patalik is a town on the banks of Indus River. After Patalik, within 20 kilometers, it enters into the Pakistan occupied territory. Indus River enters. An incursion as well. And then there was Turtuk. Turtuk is a very typical Buddhist name. That is north of Patalik, very close to Siachen. So these are all the areas they had occupied. So one by one, India started evicting them. First, they evicted the mountains which was directly overseeing the Indian National Highway. Then they went after them in the terrain behind them. So it took from roughly early May to early July, 2 months it took for us to evict them. Because they were entrenched in a higher mountain, and so they had the logistical advantage. So finally, Indian Army could prevail upon them and throw them out. 4th July, we captured the Tiger Hills. That became a very big sensation in the country. It was out of the first war which was fought after India became a digital country. Once our electronic media became very popular, private television channels started coming in. Barkha Dutt owes her entire credibility to Kargil War. She was just a young journalist then. She covered the Kargil War, and while she was covering it, the Bofors guns were firing. And so that, nobody in India ever saw it live. First time they are seeing a war on live TV. So all these people became sensational, and the capture of Tiger Hill was monitored almost on a daily basis on television programs. So that gave an impetus to the nation that we can do it. The whole nation was behind the government. They were all supporting the government. The government also went and did diplomatic efforts in trying to get US, Israel, so many people in our support. Israel silently started shipping lots of ammunition to us, laser guided missiles. We didn't have sufficient bullets with us. Okay, we had, but that may not be sufficient. Some missiles, Stinger missiles, all the equipment was supplied by Israel stealthily. Though countries like USA had told Israel to go slow on supplies. They had told Israel not to supply to India urgently. But Israel didn't listen. They said, India needs support at this stage, we will go and support them. So Israel stood by India during Kargil War. That is the reason why immediately after that, Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee sent our Foreign Minister and our Defence Minister to Israel, and our relationship with Israel significantly improved after the Kargil War. And we have all seen our current Prime Minister Modi ji had gone to Israel now. That is the first Prime Ministerial visit now. But the biggest help we got from Israel was during the Kargil War. In 1971 war, we did not even have a diplomatic relation with Israel. Still they supplied ammunition to us. But in Kargil War, we had diplomatic relations. Nobody was willing to help, including our friend Russia. But Israel supported us. This is the reality of the international friendship. China, which is touted to be the all-weather friend of Pakistan, did not come to the rescue of Pakistan. Because if they came to the rescue of Pakistan, it would have become an international UN issue and it would have blown out of proportions. So China kept quiet. So the Pakistanis were left to India to handle them. So even now, Pakistan is talking so much about the friendship with China, but if there is a real conflict, nobody is going to come to the rescue. Similarly, India also has to fight its battles on its own. We may have friends, but they may not come to our rescue in the hour of need. In the hour of need, our friend Russia did not come to the rescue. The world superpower USA did not come to our rescue. A small country, Israel, came to our rescue. So who comes to our rescue? Who are our friends in the hour of our urgent crisis? is what we need to be careful about. So this Kargil, what has happened, it's history now. Lot of positives are there. We won the war, finally we evicted them. But we should also take some lessons out of it. Why did the Pakistanis come and occupy in the first place? That means there is an intelligence failure. We did not understand the Pakistani mindset well enough. So what has India done after that? The entire line of control, they have put fencing now. Earlier there was no fencing. Now they have covered the fencing wherever it is possible. But where there is a river or there is a mountain, you cannot put a fencing. So those areas are still open. So infiltration still happens. Earlier during winter, our army used to vacate these high posts. But now, even during winter, army is taking up those positions and we are still manning the line of control. So a lot of changes have happened. Then we produced a mountain division of army of 80,000 people after the Kargil war. Because we were not prepared for a mountain war at that time. The mountain, as I told you, high altitude sickness, and you cannot handle heights of that nature in a war. But then 80,000 Indian army were prepared to handle mountain warfare. Today in Doklam, in Sikkim, you all are, must be hearing in the TVs and newspapers, we have a standoff with China. We are sitting in an advantage position on top of the mountain and China is below us. So they are making a hell lot of a noise in their paper and TV. They are saying India is intruder, they should get out, we will go to war. They are shouting. But they are unable to do anything because we are in an advantageous position. With this 80,000 mountain division which was created after Kargil. Remember sometime back I said, if you forget history, you are condemned to repeat it. So we did not forget our history. We knew that we had a weakness in mountain warfare. So we produced army which could handle mountain warfare, and today we are able to stand up against China. China has twice our army size, but yet we are able to stand up against them. That is because we learnt our lessons in Kargil. Similarly, at that time we took a decision, Vajpayee ji took a decision not to cross the line of control. But now strategically, India is prepared. India is not going to keep quiet. If such a thing happens, India will cross the line of control. And that was demonstrated when our army did a surgical strike across the line of control a few months back. So this time around, if it is going to happen, Pakistan knows that it is not going to be like in Kargil, we are going to cross the line of control. So they will think 10 times before they do an adventure. So as India learned these lessons, we also had a Kargil review committee which went into the reasons why this incursion happened, what are the failures. We were very open, transparent about it. Yes, we failed somewhere. That is the reason why Pakistanis came in. But this committee report was made public, except the very critical secret parts of it pertaining to the nuclear issues. Rest of it is all available in public. All the public is aware of it today. Whereas Pakistan did not even have this commission ever done. Now, what repercussions Pakistan had after this war? Pakistan lost democracy. Nawaz Sharif was dethroned and Musharraf took over as the army chief. As a president, martial law was imposed. They lost democracy. While our democracy improved, our stock exchange went 30% within 6 months after the Kargil war. That shows that we are a very strong democracy. We are a vibrant, developing democracy. Whereas their economy slipped, their quality slipped, the quality of people went down. Overall, their conditions are completely deteriorated. Today we know what the condition of Pakistan is today. At that time, probably we were 3 times better than them. Today, we are at least 10 times better than Pakistanis. They have completely slipped after the Kargil war. So some lessons have to be learned in this. Your generation probably has not even, as I said, you were very young, you did not know what it is. It will be good if you guys can go onto the YouTube, check out some of these videos and see for yourself what all happened. And as a picnic or a corporate plan, I mean, you guys should plan to visit some of these forward areas. If you go to these places, then your patriotism will really rekindle. You are seeing the enemy opposite side, you see the line of control, you see the army soldier. He is probably your age or a little over your age, 22, 25. He is not old enough, 25 years. And he is dying for whose sake? He is dying for your sake. You have this kind of freedom, you can shout at the government, you can abuse it, you know, whatever, you have absolute freedom, do whatever you want. It is not easy, my friends. I'm telling you, you can't even breathe. In such circumstances, our army is fighting the battle for us. on these occasions when India won the wars, be it 65, 71, Kargil, we have to take that 1 minute time to really think of them and then pay our respects to them. Can I request all of you to stand up and give 1 minute of silence for the Kargil heroes?